Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson, sponsored by T-Mobile and the MyTouch 3G Fender Limited Edition.
Thank you. Please sit down and relax. Please, you probably don't recognize me without my makeup and black dress on. If I had a nickel for every time I've said that. Ooh, I do like a bit of a sing-song with Rosie. I thought that was a good one. Didn't you think that was? I know I did say to everybody, anyone who watches the show regularly, I'm sorry. But you'll know that I did say I was never doing any puppet music things again. And the reason I did is after I said I wouldn't do it is because I lied. That's the thing to remember about me. I really am a bad boy. But you like that, don't you? And not just because we crossed the gender boundaries here at the show. Actually, it is. That's the only good thing that happened. Actually, it's a very sad day for American literature. The legendary author J.D. Salinger passed away today at the age of 91. Yeah, well, he was 91. Come on. I mean, yeah, it's terribly sad, but 91. No, he was best known, of course, for his 1951 novel Catcher in the Rye, which is considered... He can't hear you. Even when he was alive, I happen to know he never watched this show, so... Catcher in the Rye have considered, of course, the signature book about teenage angst. In 1951, disaffected teens were into well-crafted prose. This was before teens became sexy vampires and expressed themselves through their abs. Catcher in the Rye was the first part of Salinger's famous trilogy, Catcher in the Rye, Shortstop in the Rye, and then Catcher in the Rye 3, Rye Harder. Well, the kids are like, what? I didn't... No, there's no sequel to Catcher in the Rye. It sold 65 million copies, but Salinger didn't want it exploited for profit. And I respect his refusal to let his work become over-commercialized. It reminds me of my autobiography, American on Purpose, which is available at bookstores throughout the land. I will not have that book over-commercialized. Or my other book, Between the Bridge and the River, which is also available at fine bookstores. I would not have that one over-commercialized either. All right, he was a genius and I'm a whore. Anyway, if you haven't read Catcher in the Rye, it's great. There's not much plot in it, really. There's a prep school kid, Holden Caulfield, goes home to New York City for 3 days. He does normal teenager stuff. He talks to imaginary Eskimos. He has a quasi-gay encounter with an older man. And he gets beaten up by a pimp. Which, for me, is a typical Saturday night. But apparently in the 50s... Now, Holden Caulfield's main thing was that he hates phonies. He absolutely hates phonies. So he's lucky he was in New York, because if he hated phonies and came to L.A., his head would explode. Holden you're so misunderstood. You should be on a reality show.
What I'm saying is there's phonies in LA, but I don't think that's going to make the news. The title of the book, Catcher in the Rye, was taken from Holden, the character, mishearing the old rhyme by the Scottish poet Robert Burns. The line in the poem is, can a body kiss a body coming through the rye? But Holden thinks it's can a body catch a body coming through the rye, so he decides he wants to be Catcher in the Rye. Now, some critics think that in the book this means that Holden is mentally ill. But anyone who's ever heard a Scotsman recite Robert Burns... especially after about that... It's perfectly understandable that he didn't understand. You can't understand. I'm from there, I can't understand. I mean, it's something going, there's a feed or something. Poor lazy guys are sitting. Catching the Rye. Anyway, ever since Catcher in the Rye was published, Salinger refused numerous offers from Hollywood to make it into a movie. It's never been a movie. He even turned down Steven Spielberg. I know. In the 1970s, Salinger said he almost sold the rights to Jerry Lewis, but he didn't. I think he got cold feet when... Jerry Lewis? Catcher in the Rye? I think he got cold feet when he saw Jerry Lewis doing a dramatic reading of Catcher in the Rye. Lady! There's a catcher in the rye! Jerry Lewis? I love Jerry Lewis, but Catcher in the Rye? The Catcher in the Rye has a strange distinction in American schools. It's one of the most frequently taught books and one of the most frequently banned books. Some parents get very mad at it because Holden says in the word bastard 58 times in the book, and the F word he says 6 times, which I think is, that's like the first 5 minutes of this show, but apparently... I mean, what kind of bastard wouldn't... But you take it. What kind of
I caramba
bastard would ban Catcher in the Rye? It's a great work of literature. Because it contains the word
I caramba
and the word bastard, why would that be a problem? Let me get this. Well, there'll be an ooh la la or an I caramba on the F word, but none on the bastard. I'm allowed to say bastard, right? You'll just have to imagine what the other word I said is. And it appears 6 times in Catcher in the Rye, which means it's a brainy word. Anyway, after he wrote Catcher in the Rye, Salinger was best known for becoming a recluse. He was famous for wanting to not be famous.
Oh. I renamed my old reclusive friend.
He retreated to a farm in New Hampshire, and he refused to do any publicity. And even as the artistic achievement grew, there was scarcely a word about him in any newspaper or magazine in America. It's like he disappeared. It's like he had his own show at 12:30 on CBS.
Did you just compare yourself to J.D. Salinger, Craig?
I did, but only in the fact that many people have no idea who the
heck I am.
All right. Seems fair. To be honest, I'm not sure what qualifies as being a recluse. I have no idea what Paulie Shore is doing these days. Does that mean he's a recluse? Or what about that gorgeous woman, Chastity Bono? Nobody's heard from her in a while. What's she up to?
But I digress. America lost a great writer today. That's sad. But I'll cheer you up later with fart jokes.
And now, Craig's Spanish word of the day. Today's word is...
ombligo. Ombligo.
Welcome back, everyone. Hey, hey!
Hey!
Look at that! We did a catchphrase! It's a catchphrase like it's a... I'll do it again so you at home can join in. Here's what you do, everybody. When I say hey, hey, you...
Hey!
When I say hey, hey...
Hey!
Thank you. Then you at home, get out of bed, take all your clothes off, run outside, and shout, hey, hey.
Hey!
No, no, don't applaud, because you don't know if they really did it. I thought it would be a good thing to encourage, you know, to get more of a sense of community with the, you know, the studio audience and the viewer at home. And when I say viewer, I mean viewer. It gives a sense of community that we're all in this together. Hey, hey! That's right. We have time for emails. You bet we do, everybody. Good. All right, this is from Jill in San Diego. Oh, one of my favorite cities in America. I'm trying to be perky as well, see how it works. I quite like San Diego, though. Well, it's all right. The trouble is that San Diego has the San Diego Chargers, which is the nearest NFL team to L.A., so you kind of root for them every year, because if you live in L.A. and you like football, that's the nearest option. So you go, oh, the Chargers are going to be great until the playoffs, and then you go, ugh. Anyway, disappointment's what I do. This is from Jill in San Diego, anyway. She said, I tried to get tickets to your show, but they're sold out. Sold out? For here? They're free! You want to come to the show? Just show up! You think these people have any money? Hey, hey! If they had money, they'd be off doing something more exciting. Anyway, she said, maybe instead I could be your guest, since you have an extra seat on the stage. Yeah, all right. Yeah. Book Jill, will you? Jill from San Diego. My next guest is Jill from San Diego. Hi. Have you been to SeaWorld? Shamu lives in San Diego, doesn't he? Yeah. Well, not by choice. Hey, all right, yeah, I'm the bad guy. I took the killer whale and put him in a big pond. There you are, Shamu, that'll be nice. Comfortable swimming pool for you to live in. I mean, what I'm saying is, if Shamu could get away, he would. It's nothing against San Diego, he's just a killer whale. He'd bugger off, he'd go elsewhere. It's not like if they opened the gates to the swimming pool and said, Shamu, all your stuff's there, but you can leave if you want. Do you think Shamu would go, nah, I'm good. I'll just stay here splashing the kids. He might, though, he might. Let's test it. This is from Joshua in Chicago. Joshua says, dearest Craig, easy. Your show is called The Late Late Show. Usually when something is late, that means it's dead. When exactly did this show expire? I'd say about halfway through the monologue tonight. When I decided tonight's topical monologue was going to be an obituary in our own style to the great J.D. Salinger, that's when I knew I was making a terrible mistake. Late night terms, but then again, if you do all the right things in late night, they can fire you. So I know. We have to take a commercial break, but when we come back, we'll talk for a while and then there'll be another one. You might as well know. This won't be the last commercial break of the night. There'll be more. But I have a feeling this one's going to be good. We'll be right back, everyone. My first guest tonight has got an HP. It's got an HBO documentary coming out on HBO. It's called A Family is a Family is a Family. It premieres Sunday night at 7 on HBO. Premium cable. Only in the best motels. Take a look at this.
Please welcome my friend Rosie O'Donnell, everybody. Rosie O'Donnell.
They're a good crowd.
On their feet.
They are. All right, everybody, watch.
Hey, hey. Yeah. Sweet, sweet.
They're terrible. They're terribly nice. They must be here for you. Normally, when people come in here, they're surly. But they're these people seem quite pleasant.
Hey, hey.
Oh. No, I don't want to do that.
Can I just say thank you for letting me do a little puppet number? Hey, I know you were done with puppets. But my kids, we watch it frequently on YouTube, all your puppets. And my daughter said to me, why can't you ever be on something good like this?
Really?
Really. And I said, I actually know him. He is my friend.
Really?
Well, then why don't you do it? I said, well, I'm going to ask. And then I asked.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, and now when I go home, I'm going to pull it up on YouTube. Because whenever I try to pull up anything on YouTube to show them that I have validity, you know,
right,
with the younger kids,
yeah,
they always say, you were a teenager then. Hurtful.
You shouldn't let them talk to you like that.
I know, but what can I
do? Make them read J.D. Salinger. That'll shut them up.
And as they're reading it, I'll say, he's dead.
Oh, don't
enjoy it. There will never be another one.
Oh, no. Did you ever read that book?
I did.
Did you like it?
No, I thought it was a spoiled rich kid complaining about life.
Take that, J.D.
Yeah.
And you thought you were having a bad day.
He hasn't been seen in like 25 years.
No,
he could have been dead a long time.
Yeah, that's true. Maybe they just released the information
today.
Maybe.
He was hiding, hibernating. He was gone. He wrote one book. He said, that's enough stress.
Well, you know, if I could write one great book, I would never have written another one. What's that? To Kill a Mockingbird. That's a great... She never wrote another book, Harper Lee, did
she? No, that's a fantastic
book. That's maybe the best book I've ever read. You ever read that book?
I love that book. Yes. Scout.
Yeah.
Come on.
That's great, isn't it?
Boo Radley.
Yeah, Boo Radley.
I want to say this. This is very suck-uppy to say in a show, but both of your books are fantastic, and your first book was the best first novel I ever read of anyone.
Well, thanks very much.
You're welcome. Thank you. I love that.
Yeah, well, thanks.
It should be a movie.
No, it can't be a movie.
Why? Just because J.D. Salinger said it, now you don't want to do it?
That's exactly right.
Such a copycat.
No, me and J.D., we feel the same about our books.
Yeah.
Don't make them into movies.
No, all right.
No, I made movies, and I realized how badly I suck at that.
That was a good pot movie you made.
Well, I was on pot then.
No,
I wasn't. Did you smoke a lot of pot at any point?
Not until I was like 40.
Make any sense.
I know. I did it once when I was in high school, and I thought I had no saliva. I was walking around like, I'm going to die. I have to go to the emergency room. I have no saliva.
But that's not an emergency. No saliva is you just get a beverage. It's not, you don't go to the emergency room with no saliva.
No, I was one of those people cowering in the corner, having like flashbacks and hallucinations. And then it wasn't until I left my show, and right, I was 40 years old, and a friend of mine said, well, now you're free, and you got no job, and here you go. And I was like, wow. When the kids are at school, this is kind of enjoyable.
Okay.
But I gotta say, it can cause a lot of trouble, and you should really use it in moderation.
What the hell happened to you all of a sudden? What happened here?
Well, you know, I did the year without beer. I told you that, right?
Oh, you did?
I did the year without beer.
How's that been?
Really good, to tell you the truth.
Oh, really?
I needed it. Yeah, my little baby on our sixth birthday got a magic eight ball.
Right.
And it said, yes, for sure. She said, do you want to know what my wish was, my question? I said, yeah, sure, thinking it was going to be, you know.
Yeah.
She said, I asked if mommy would stop drinking beer. And mommy put down the Sam Adams.
Yeah.
And mommy had a year without beer. So then on her birthday this year, she had a magic eight ball again, and I said, give me that for, you know. no way, baby, no. But, yeah, Irish, honey.
Yo,
you don't have to tell me.
I've had 18 years without beer.
I know.
Beer,
no, yeah. That's a good thing, too.
That's for me and for the local law enforcement agency.
Well, I feel everybody wins, on the whole.
Oh, no, I was crazy.
Yeah.
I was just crazy. Now, listen, tell me about the documentary Families of Families of Family. What is that about, then?
Families.
Is it really?
Yeah. Yeah, it's
cute. Is it like the other one? I like the other one when you went on the cruise with the gay families. Are you doing that again?
Kelly's doing that still.
Right, okay.
She's got the cruises every year on our family vacations. But this one is all about little kids talking about what their families are made up. And then we have some musical performances like Ziggy Marley and his mom and his sister. And isn't Ziggy the dad?
Bob.
Bob was the dad. Okay. For a moment, I thought I did a J.D. Salinger talking about somebody who was dead. Wait a minute.
No.
It was Ziggy.
Bob Marley is
he's gone. He is not in the documentary. Don't look for him.
No. He's
somewhere.
We say in show business he's unavailable.
Unavailable. Okay. Yeah. And so it's a bunch of little kids talking about their families. Remember that show? I don't know because you were in Scotland, but here in America, we had a show in the 70s called Free to Be You and Me.
And I don't remember. I didn't call
that. It was really very profound at the time. Marlo Thomas got together with a bunch of her friends in the 70s and wanted to teach little girls about equality and about feminism. And so she got together with all her friends and made this amazing documentary that showed kids about equality. So I went and had dinner with Marlo a couple of years ago, and I said, can I have the rights to that? And she said, oh, Rosie, you don't need the rights. Just get your friends together and talk about what it is that you care about.
And then, so it's about making a family.
Because your family is made up and how every family is unique and individual, like a snowflake. And they, are all the same, but different configurations. And they all deserve validity, respect, and honor.
Oh, that's right.
Isn't that nice? The kids talk about love in this documentary.
Yeah, yeah.
They say, you know, this one little girl goes, love is like a virus that there's no cure for.
That's true.
That's exactly what it's like.
That's true.
You can never stop it. Once it gets inside of your body, it never goes away. Very adorable. The kids say the most profound and funny things without even realizing.
Do they say the darndest things? Sometimes kids say the darndest.
No, not in this documentary, they don't. There's no darndest. Didn't Jay do that for a while?
Jay Leno?
Jay Leno. Didn't he do the kids say the darndest things?
Have you been following it?
No, what's new with Jay?
You know what? We have to take a break, but when we come back, let's talk about that.
Well, he was on Oprah today.
I saw it. Yeah, let's talk about that.
Just let me say something. If you have something to hide, don't go on Oprah Winfrey.
Yeah, welcome back, everybody. I'm here with Rosie O'Donnell, who's just popped by to tell us what she thinks about the late night situation over at NBC.
Well, have you been following it at all, Craig?
I never watch NBC. But I took a look at it. See, the thing is, when I watch it, it's different because I'm watching the competition shooting themselves in the foot and just laughing my ass off.
Well, that would be a good place for you to be. I saw you sort of duck your head and wait till it all simmered down.
Well,
right?
You know,
what could you do? It's hard to take shots when they're all wounded, right?
Yeah, yeah. But you didn't. You said, you were Team Coco, weren't you, really?
Well, here's the thing. You know, I've been at this career now for 30 years.
Really?
Yeah, I started at 17. I'm about to be 48 years old.
Wow.
And I know all the players, right? I did stand-up comedy in Boston when I was 18. Jay Leno was the big star. And so I've known him a long time, and I know Conan, and he's a great guy. And so it's weird when you get to be in a position where you actually know the players, right? So it's not just sort of people on TV. You really know them, and you know their families, and you know you have a history with them. And I just felt it was a crappy thing to do, you know, that Conan had been working 17 years for that company. And then, you know, Jay was told 5 years ago that it was his turn to give up the driver's seat, right?
Right.
That is not his bus. That's a 60-year bus that's been driving around the country that tonight's on. And if you're lucky enough to get to drive it, when they say, hey, you're done, you give the keys back and you say, thank you. You don't flatten the tires of the guy who comes next, you know?
Right.
So to me, I don't know. Crappy thing to do.
I don't know.
And, you know, I think if they all had that cool Cobra mug, they all would have done a lot better.
See you.
What the hell is that?
Well, I tell you what this is.
From Jungle Book?
This is free, is what that is.
Oh, it was free.
Do you know what I think about the Tonight Show? Do you know what I honestly think?
What do you honestly think?
I honestly think the Tonight Show stopped when Johnny Carson retired.
What
the hell else are they talking about?
I agree, yes.
That's
35 years.
Yeah, that's Johnny Carson. That's Johnny Carson's show, the Tonight Show. Do another show now.
I agree, do another show. But the swarmy thing was, you know, Jay saying, you know, well, my show didn't work. And then they said to me, hey, you want to go on for a half hour? I said, oh, sure. Is Conan okay with that? No, he's not okay with that.
No.
He's not okay with that. What do you mean? Is he okay with that? No! He's not okay! He's shocked. Is that loud?
Yeah.
So my kids.
What about you? Why don't you come back and do a show?
You think?
Yeah, I think it's time.
You know, I left on my show 8 years ago, right? That's a long time.
It's a nice long break. You've done a couple of documentaries.
Yeah.
You know, you've done this, done that. Come back and do some TV.
Yeah, I don't know.
Because you're doing the radio now. I was listening to you on the radio.
It's so fun.
It's great. I listened to you and Howard talk for about an hour.
Yeah.
Well, no commercial breaks. No, just talking. And I've got to be honest, I'd forgotten how great Howard was. I haven't listened to him in a while.
And he really is, and I have to say, the fact that he and I are now friends makes me believe...
Yeah, and how long's that going to last, by the way? Come on.
It's been like 2 years.
Yeah, come on.
Well, ever since when I got married, he changed his whole tune to me.
Really?
Like, for years, for 10, 15 years of my career, he was calling me Pumpkinhead, Fat Lesbo. He was calling me... I would, like, be pushing...
He calls me that now.
I know, I've heard him say that about you. No, I'd be pushing, like, a two-year-old in the stroller at Target,
right.
And I'd see some T-shirt, black T-shirt kid go, hey, Rude, blah, blah, blue, and he scared the... out of me.
Really?
I never even mentioned his name. People would say in interviews, what do you think about Howard Stern? I would say, no comment. I was terrified of the guy, right?
And he is scary. He's scary.
Yeah.
I think he's quite frightening because he's unpredictable.
Right.
He's a maverick and he's extremely erudite and he thinks very fast. So if he doesn't like you, he'll make you look really stupid.
And if he doesn't believe that you're authentic, if he thinks you're full, he will let you know.
I know.
You know? And so he thought I was full of it for a very long time. And so then I did his program on the radio, on the phone, because I was afraid. And then I went and did it and sat down. And after I did a show, he's the one who got me the job.
You're kidding me.
He called up the head of person at Sirius and he said, you know, she would be good at this. And the truth is, I had never listened to radio in my whole life. You know, I would listen to the hits, the pop, top pop, you know, stuff.
Yeah.
But I wouldn't listen to talk radio ever. So I didn't even know if I could do it. And I only started listening to Howard once I got the gig.
You're right.
And that guy is a genius. He really goes and pushes it to the edge. And his obsession with sex reminds me of the teenagers living in my home.
Yeah.
But that guy is really unbelievably gifted.
Yeah, I think so. I'm a bit scared of him as well, though. I'm actually a bit scared to even talk about him.
Yeah, well, you know. You've never done a show?
I did a show once when I started on this, doing this show.
Uh-huh.
I was in New York, I was doing a little press tour, and they said, go and do Howard's show. And I was scared to go and do Howard's, but he was quite nice to me on the air. And then off the air, he was really nice to me.
Yeah.
And he said, you know, I wish I could do an impersonation of him, but I can't. But he said, I'll just make him German.
Okay, go ahead.
He said, you have to make it your own. So in order for the show to work, but I can't do Howard, but I can do German.
Okay,
Just go with me on this.
He's a Jew. Don't do German.
All right.
It's not right. It's freaking me out.
All right, Italian.
Give me an Italian. Go ahead.
He says to me, hey, Craig, I tell you this.
Okay.
You're going to make it all your own, okay?
Yeah.
Do that.
Yeah. So that was, did he hand you cannoli or anything?
No, he's not really Italian.
Oh, okay. So he is actually very kind, and the thing that you really do learn is he's got this huge, tender heart, which, you know, the guy on his show is sidekick, Artie Lang, very funny comedian.
Poor Artie, how is he?
He's doing better, and he's got a lot of trouble with addiction and depression in his life, and his dad died when he was young, and he tried to take his own life.
Yeah,
and it really, really was so painful to everyone who loved him, including Howard.
Mm.
And so on the internet, I was watching somebody made a tribute tape, and, you know, as Artie was struggling and crying in the years that he worked there, like, Howard gets up and goes and hugs him. He's a real tender-hearted guy, and he wears it all on his face. So I think that whole thing of his big bravado and scary Howard is just an act, you know?
Oh, I think it's an act, but I think that he's so good at being scary that when you say it's an act, he'll eviscerate you for saying that. You know?
To me, he was like Lord Voldemort. I wouldn't say his name, you know?
Yeah.
I just was like, you know, on the press line walking through, hey, Howard Stern thinks you suck.
I was scary,
but now I think there could be peace all over the world because he and I are hanging out, and it's actually enjoyable.
I think long may it continue. We're kind of out of time, really.
Oh, well, do you know, here's the thing. I just have to say this. They don't like you to really bring gifts to this show, apparently.
No, I don't want the staff getting...
I didn't bring for the staff.
Okay, fair
enough.
I
just brought for these people.
Oh, okay.
People, and J.D. Salinger is still dead. We got you the satellite radio so you could listen to Sirius and a subscription for 2 months for everybody here.
Wow! That's
easy.
We never get stuff like that out here.
I know, snuck
That's
it in.
That's fantastic.
And I got a big one for you.
You did?
Yeah, and they made me learn how to program it. They sent a guy to my house and they're like, you have to teach Craig how to do this. I'm like, What?
I do listen to satellite radio. I listen to you, of course, uh-huh. and I listen to Howard in case he goes after me. Uh-huh. And also, I listen to 115, the classic radio.
Yeah, oh, that's awesome. Fun stuff.
Who knows? The shadow knows. No, behind yeah. the couch, all that. Yeah.
Well, you got a brand new one, even better than the crap I gave them. Oh. In your room.
Rosie O'Donnell, everybody. We'll be right back. My next guests are an iconic rock band. You can catch them on tour this spring. They're here performing One Wing from their Grammy-nominated album, Wilco, the album. That's a clue to who they are. Wilco, everybody, Wilco! All right. Well, here's some things we learned on the show. J.D. Salinger and Bob Marley. Both of them unavailable. We also learned that even when I put on a black dress and fishnets, I just look like a dude in black net. We learned this. What was the Spanish word of the day? Ombligo. Ombligo. Yeah, ombligo, belly button. I had my ombligo pierced, everybody. No, I didn't. Look at me. Belly button pierced? You mad? I've never understood how you can have your belly button pierced anyway. It's just like it's a little bit of fat next to it, isn't it? I've got too much fat next to it. I think if you had to pierce mine, you'd need to use a nail gun. We also learned nothing else, actually. That's pretty much it. So I'd best be going. I feel like I'm kind of duty-bound to say my catchphrase, but I don't want to. All right. Hey, hey!